We can turn to our last talk in this session, which is given by Mark Alves from the Montgomery College, and he will be talking about Austroasiatic etymology in a Southeast Asian aerial context, sociocultural words. And Mark also provided us with a link to his presentation in the chat.
Okay, so etymology, I'll focus on words. Austroasiatic, which is essentially the oldest language family, existing language family in mainland Southeast Asia. And by looking at sociocultural terms, I'm not looking at basic vocabulary. And so that means the words are more likely to be exchanged. I've looked at other kinds of words in the past, but material culture items that have archaeological support for them, such as metals, metal terms, even domesticated birds and some other kinds of terms. But for these, it's more problematic, as you will see. So we can begin by looking at Shorto's Mon-Khmer. I'm going to use the term Austroasiatic consistently for various theoretical reasons. I won't explain Austroasiatic reconstructions. And he provides, there's a publication with over 2,000 Austroasiatic reconstructions. And the data he gathered was largely in the latter part of the 20th century. Paul Sobel published that in 2006, very, very generously. And there are many reconstructions with attestations of these forms in several Austroasiatic branches, some including Munduk or Nicobaric. And wow, that's great. Then we think we have some genuine proto-Austroasiatic terms if we see them both in mainland Southeast Asia and external portions. But there are many, many more with limited support. For example, having two branch attestations in just two branches of Austroasiatic with only one language each, he reconstructs some of those. So you can, hypothetically, you can. I published an article a few years ago where I pointed out that some Chinese loanwords in Vietnamese. And therefore, if you have a Palangic word and then one word is a Sino-Vietnamese word, the the reconstruction disappears. So, and then some with just a few branches in a small geographic region, which is obviously interesting, but can we consider that proto-Austroasiatic? What do such reconstructions represent? So my first takeaway here is Shorto's Austroasiatic reconstructions and accompanying notes in that book are extremely valuable, but they must be carefully and critically reevaluated and contextualized both geographically and chronologically. We need context for these. So there are definitely some past challenges, but new opportunities. As we all know, a complex regional situation for Austroasiatic etymology in Southeast Asia, with that Southeast Asian interphyla loanword situation always complicated, regional words of uncertain origins in general, and of course the typological convergence, restructuring and simplification of prosodic words, all of this increases uncertainty. There's a lot of chance partial and full similarity of forms. We have to be aware of this. And more challenges. Shorto's incredible knowledge, his skills, and large accumulation of linguistic data in his time could not solve the problems with this still limited data and the challenges in efficiently exploring and effectively accounting for that data. It's paper, right? That was the time of paper. And so the paths to progress are the vast amounts of digitized lexical data in the last 15 years or so, or a little bit more. And this can advance both Austroasiatic reconstructions and Southeast Asian etymological research, as well as related matters of ethnohistory. And so these sources, these modern lexical databases, we might as well call it the Austroasiatic Etymological Dictionary, those first two there that Paul also spearheaded, and the proto-diomatic with many with multiple proto reconstructions for the Sino-Tibetan side, the spreadsheets of Baxter and Cigar, the Xiao Shui Tang Wenzi Xue Zi Liao Ku is just amazing with hundreds of Chinese dialects. So we shouldn't just look at Cantonese anymore, okay? We check for more than that because Southern Chinese is more than Cantonese. The Sino-Tibetan Etymological Dictionary, massive, very hard to sometimes figure things out. It's so amazing. It's a mess and it's an amazing tool. Austronesian, bless Austronesian. The dictionaries, when you search, you can search, which if I search for the word dog, I'm going to find every entry that has anything to do with dog and the dictionaries of South Asia. So this tremendous volume of data and powerful searching tools and general speed of finding this information, it's a true game changer. I hate the term game changer. I think it's a cliche, but I do think this is legitimate. So for this study, the lexical evidence of sociocultural contact. And these are the categories that I have been looking at. And so when I do it, here, I'll just show you briefly. Here, these are the, you know, I've got my little documents, files. I'll show you one in a moment here. And so focusing on these, as you can see, we don't have any body parts and numbers and basic vocabulary. General trade items, worn items, again, you know, things potentially tradable, constructed location, means of transport. So these words are tested only in mainland Southeast Asia, meaning they cannot be reconstructed to Proto-Austroasiatic. I don't think we can. I mean, you could try to claim it, but I don't think we can. And mostly represent, I believe, post-dispersal language history in the region. Okay, so basically it's a picture also of Southeast Asian language history. Criteria for assessment. The usual suspects, of course, we apply the comparative method and observable phonological patterns and semantic correspondences. We look at quantity, the number of branches that have attestations, the number of languages in the branches and the total number. We, of course, consider the geography, the geographic range and identifiable subregions. We consider the important language contact events, the Proto-Austroasiatic dispersal, but the Han Dynasty expansion, the Dai expansion, you know, all of these within centuries, not specific dates or anything like that. And of course, the centers of cultural spread, groups known for cultural innovations and sociocultural status, China, the Khmer Kingdoms, Mon Kingdom, Viet Mong of the Red River Delta, Champa, Thai Kingdoms. Okay, so we keep these in mind. We have to look at these more carefully, but at least we know of these and it requires more exploration. As yet, little archaeological data clarifies the histories of these words in the study, but the ethnohistorical information can still allow hypotheses. So forms of headwear, okay, forms for headwear, that is. And let me show you, this is a working sheet that I have. And so you can see all of these language groups here, some language families, as well as specific language groups, 14 pages. Color coded for these different kinds of forms. And then as you go through, you start to see the colors popping out. Okay, so this is not a completely a computerized method. It is still eyeball. I'm using my eyes to find things. Okay, I do think it's important for humans to be involved in that process and not just computerized. And so I'm going to present things this way. I can't present all of the data, but I can present a few snapshots. And so what I have are these forms. It's impossible to reconstruct something if it's in three different language families, right? And so, I mean, you can, but it's not very practical for a variety of reasons. And so I use this shorthand of all caps with approximate word shapes, okay? So this is not representative of precise phonological details. Then the branches of Austroasiatic in which forms are attested. And this does not have numbers. I don't indicate, for example, in three languages in Bahnaric. I do that elsewhere for myself, but that's just overwhelming information. At this point, this is sufficient. And then other types of languages, as you can see, things like Old Chinese Proto-Dai. I always kind of put the Indic ones towards the bottom because I know less about them, but I have to acknowledge them. And then some notes. And so, for example, the Muk form as being possibly Old Chinese, perhaps Via Dai into mainland Southeast Asia, Austroasiatic. But the Mu form is actually the same etymon from Chinese, but a different stage. And it is in early loanword in Vietnamese. And so it is in Vietic, essentially going into Eastern Austroasiatic. And I can check this, right? Those sources allow me to make these broad generalizations and tentative hypotheses. Okay, these are tentative hypotheses. And of course, I'm keeping in mind, historical cultural trends, but it all needs more careful checking. Don, which Duan, Vietnamese non, I don't believe it to be a Chamic innovation. I'm tentatively considering it an Eastern Austroasiatic innovation. But is it Khmeric? Is it Vietic? There is a piece of archaeological information, a bronze image from Ban Chiang there in the northeast Thailand, so maybe from the mid first millennium BC, that is. And so, okay, maybe Khmeric, I don't know, but I can't say. So I'll just call it Eastern Austroasiatic innovation. Another possible Chinese form, and then some Indic ones. This one in Khmer has, instead of Mala, I think it's Mielia, which suggests, I think, the vowel change. Of the vowel change suggests that it is perhaps older in Khmer, and there's some semantic shift and those kinds of things, okay? When it comes to things which are in Hindi, I really have no idea how to time these. Are these very recent? I don't have enough information about them, so I don't do too much, just saying probably Indic and then indicating where I have found them, and I did not find it in Sanskrit or Pali. Okay, in those dictionaries. So this is the approach I'm taking, okay? And forms for footwear, all right? We go from headwear to footwear. And so we have this kind of cup form in several Austroasiatic branches. And I can just call it an Austroasiatic innovation. And again, notice it's all mainland Southeast Asia. I did not find these in Nicobarese or Munda languages. The yep form is probably, I think, a Vietnamese form. It is only in a few languages in Catuic and Vietic, okay? No timing here, I'm not indicating timing, but that's what we have here. So it could be, century, could be centuries, could be millennia. I don't think this one is, but since it says shallow, it seems like shallow history. Also the pronunciation, there's some reasons. A couple of Chinese types and the one which is high, I think the Zay form is a very early, older Chinese form. Hai is probably more recent in Southern Chinese. And I don't say Cantonese, even though in Cantonese it is Hai, because it is in Yue, it is in Pinghua, it is in Hakka. So if there's a Hai form in all of them, I cannot randomly pick Cantonese. And I check that database, it's all over the place in Southern Chinese. Possibly early Chinese loanword, okay? Borrowed some hats, borrowed some footwear from Chinese in a fairly early period. I don't know what to say about it. This is what I found for this in Mundic specifically, likely from Hindi. I think that's reasonable, but apparently it's in Malay as well. Okay, forms for baskets. Of course, baskets are pretty significant cultural items and where there's this bung and dong forms, quite a few varieties of Austroasiatic. It has been reconstructed. These have been reconstructed in Dai. I'm simply going to say uncertain origin. There's various factors, presyllables in some of the mainland Southeast Asian languages. Does that suggest they're older? I don't know. If there's a Dai source, we would need more data. All kinds of complex factors. Oh, by the way, this one has a tone C, which is actually interesting on that Vieto-Mangic issue. Okay, Glui, I suspect this is a Dai form. It is reconstructed in Dai, which suggests it's reasonably widespread, but limited distribution in Austroasiatic, so possible Dai source. A few more forms, which appear to be Austroasiatic innovations, and notably, going into Chamic, I tend not to think that Chamic is the source for these. And I notice that in most cases, Khmeric is sort of the geographic center, and so tentatively Cymric as the source. And I think there might be some ethno-historical reasons for that to be the case, at least during the Cymric kingdoms. But again, that requires more detail, so tentative. Forms for woodwind instruments, another kind of trade item. The Ken form, I think, is generally considered to be die. I am not so sure about that. And I wonder if anybody knows any other ethnographic data for that particular word. It is pretty widespread in mainland Southeast Asian Austroasiatic languages. And one could think it's from die as they spread. I don't yet know. Maybe I can change it from uncertain to something else. But look at all of these words, which are pretty strongly Austroasiatic. And no reconstructions here. There is this one, but there's an old Khmer usage of this in the 900s. I think that largely predates the die expansion. I don't know if that's quite accurate, but it seems to me that we have plenty of flutes among the Austroasiatic groups. I think that's interesting and something that requires a little more investigation. And then another Hindi source, probable in Mundic and Cossack. For boats, we have these two have been discussed in the literature some. I thought maybe there was something outside of mainland Southeast Asia. As it turns out, not. All I can find are forms in mainland Southeast Asia. So I propose possible AA innovation. There is a comparable form in Proto-Kukichin, some of those groups, but since they are in contact with some of these, I think it's more likely from Austroasiatic into Tibeto-Burman. And then was what I believe to be a transparent proto-die loan word into these languages, the complex onset in Joe Pityaporn's reconstruction. The lack of that in these languages suggests that it is most likely from die. I think we can date it that way, even if we don't have ethno-archaeological data, the phonological data supports it. And so lastly, some forms for, we have boats, we've got oars for paddling. And this particular one, the bi form is all over the place. And there are a lot of weird semantics and maybe chance similarity. I cannot tell. It is uncertain, regional at best, insufficient, inconsistent data. But again, Khmer, Khmeric, Khmeric, even old Khmer for this particular one, I would suggest that these are all Austroasiatic lexical innovations, and it seems probable that Khmeric is at least the sociocultural center of these, and so a possible lexical innovator. So some concluding thoughts. None of these sociocultural terms are proto-Austroasiatic forms, I don't think. Thus, we must reconsider all items that the shorter reconstructed, but how do we now regard these types with limited distribution? We can consider recurring patterns for these categories of AA Austroasiatic innovations, often with Khmer, or Khmeric, I should say, as the geographic center, but not always. Early Chinese loanwords, often via Dai or Vietnamese. Dai loanwords, sometimes there's some Dai Austroasiatic words, and I don't know the direction of exchange. I'm not going to assume that Dai is always the donor. I don't think that's right. We don't have enough data to make that claim always. Regional words of uncertain origin, they still exist. The Vonderwort still exist. That's the way it is. Future methods of clarification include the following. We continue seeking lexical data, of course. Please, anybody out there who's listening now, the more data we have, the better. Please share your data, publish your data, please. Checking for language or branch level historical phonology. I'm sure that there are things that I am overlooking when I do this quickly, and I need to sometimes look at them more precisely and determine the timing of, for example, glottal features and tonogenesis and loss of presyllables or development of presyllables. Exploring semantics and ethnographic information of terms and individual languages. I skipped over baskets. There are multiple types of baskets, and this requires more careful sifting, such as the winnowing basket, that sort of thing, as opposed to a storage basket. And seeking relevant ethnohistorical and or archaeological data wherever it exists. And so that's what I have. And I would appreciate any thoughts or questions or comments.